But I want to go ahead and get started if we can. You can continue to eat, go get dessert, whatever. Especially this first section. It's not really all that in depth, but it's our history, mission, and vision. Let's pray one more time before we start. Lord, thank you for your church. Thank you that you are building your church. Thank you that the gates of hell will not prevail against your church, that you will accomplish all of your purpose, that you will save all of your people, that we will be with you forever in the new heavens and new earth, and that through every trial of this life, you are cashing them in, you are making them work for us, you are making them be an instrument that is part of our being conformed into the image of Christ. So we thank you and praise you. Thank you for the work of grace in our individual lives, and we thank you for your work of grace in Grace Church. And so as we begin to look at these introductory matters and of the church, we just pray for you to guide, lead, and protect us, and that you would bless us to marvel in your work and to give information that is needed for folks to know us better, for folks to make an informed decision on joining Grace Church. So we look to you, we lean upon you, we pray for your help, and trust you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, welcome to our introductory class. If you're interested in membership, this would be a requirement. If you're just wanting to know more about the church, we welcome that. We do put all of this information on the website. It's open to anybody, so anybody who just happens onto the website can go through these things if they want to. We're really not trying to hide anything from anybody. That's why our website is so heavy with information, theological and otherwise. But I want to start with just giving you a brief view of our history. On this second slide, this is a little bit like looking at a picture of a baby. When you look at a picture of a baby, you intuitively know that there was some pain and labor and hardship involved in getting to that point of that baby being born. And so I'll backtrack a little bit and just let you know I was saved. Cindy and I were converted together, as odd as that is. I was 26, she was 24, when we came to faith in Christ through personal crisis and searching the Word and being convinced that we were lost and needed a Savior. We knelt down in the living room floor and cried out to the Lord, and He saved us. And I had wrestled with the call to ministry since conversion. But in 2004, I actually enrolled in seminary, in Greenville Presbyterian Theological Seminary. I was 44 when I entered. I was 49 when I graduated. So graduated seminary. The Lord was not in as big a hurry as I was to provide a place of ministry. I spent a year working in the furniture store, which was all instrumental to get us moved here. I can give you all those details sometime if you want them. But basically what happened was, about a year after I had graduated seminary, I was aware of a church that was here over in Cape Carteret that was in decline because the guy that had been instrumental as a church planner was getting old and he was in bad health. And so they had dwindled down to about 22 people. About halfway through seminary, we really began to wrestle with the idea of church planting and planting a church in an area that needed one. So this seemed like a head start in that direction because they were claiming to be reformed. They were willing to do whatever necessary to replant if necessary and grow, at least seemed that way initially. But so I ended up taking that call here. We moved out here and put our house on the market during the downturn, and that took about a year to sell. It took a long time to sell. But I was at that church, Swansboro Bible Church, for almost a year. And it became obvious to me that, and to others, that they really weren't all that reformed and they really didn't want to change in order to grow and honor God. So through a number of things, I just decided to resign. Because if I was going to stay, it was going to just continue to put pressure on them and pain and because we were so different. But while we were there for that year, God gathered these folks into the church. And so they had come while we were there. They had come while we were preaching. And on the Sunday that I announced that I was going to resign, after the service, they all just kind of came to me and said, "What are you going to do?" And I said, "I don't know. I have no idea what I'm going to do." And I don't remember which one of them said it, but one of them looked at me and said, "Well, whatever you do, we're doing, because you're our pastor." And I was like, "Well, I'm not trying to pull anybody away from this church. I don't know what the Lord wants me to do." But bottom line, this became the core group of Grace Church. And this group of people met in our living room to pray and ask the Lord what He would do with us and what He would have us do. We actually went to church one Sunday together at another church and continued praying. We ended up for an interim season meeting at Ribeyes in Cape Carteret. And the way that came about, we were looking for a place to meet and went into Ribeyes in Cape Carteret, and the old gentleman who was the owner manager, he said, "Well," he said, "you can meet here for free if you'll eat here after the service." So he kind of hooked us into to buying his food. So we agreed to do that, and we were at Ribeyes for about 3 months, and we'll talk more about that in a minute. But so this is the group of folks that God used. We started out with 9, ended up 7 when the Marine Corps, they got out of the Marine Corps and moved back to California. But that was the core meeting group that God used to encourage us, and God used to cause us to stay here and work on planting a church. The other thing I will tell you is God in His sovereignty just hemmed us in here. About a month before things went south at this other church, our house in Lyman sold. There was no place to run back to. So He just kind of hemmed us in here, kept us here, had us pray. We were praying with these people. Cindy's friends came to visit one week, and I told them, I said, "I don't know if this is what we're supposed to be doing." I said, "But we're hemmed in here, and this is what He's got in front of us, so we're going to pour in here until He leads us somewhere else." And so we did. So we began meeting at Ribeyes. That next slide shows you the first sermon of Grace Church was preached from a dance floor with a beer sign in the background. So from the very beginning, we hadn't been all that uptight. but yeah, if you go to Ribeyes, you can see that, and I don't even think they've changed the sign in the back. But if you go to the back of Ribeyes, you'll see the little honky-tonk area with the dance floor and all of that. But that was the first sermon preached to, I guess, 8 people who were sitting out here in a couple of tables in front of me from the corner of the dance floor. This is, I think, our first logo. Pitiful, but that's what it looked like. Hey, listen, you go to seminary to learn theology, you never dream that you're going to have to put together a website. But when it's just you, you have to start messing with these things. So that was sort of a logo and something we came up with because we were using it to put out real estate signs and things like that. So we met in Ribeyes for about 3 months. We all got exceedingly tired of eating there every Sunday. It's great food, but when it's the same thing every Sunday, and we got to looking, there was, you know, the group of us, and we were like, okay, if I bought lunch and you bought lunch and we could take the money we're spending on lunch, eat sandwiches somewhere, and we've got some money to pay for a place to meet. So next slide, we ended up at the Best Western in Cedar Point, and which that was a provision of the Lord, because we were looking for a place to meet. And one of the ladies who was part of the group, she said, a church was meeting in the Best Western, but I think they've moved out. So we went over and talked to the manager of the Best Western. She showed us the meeting room, which, it's small. It's a small reading room, but we were small, so it worked. But she said that she would give us that meeting room every Sunday, all day long, for $50 a week. And of course, we jumped on that, because that enabled us to save money. And so by the time we left there, we were bleeding all out in the breakfast area, and, you know, God had really begun to do a work. But I do remember the Sunday when I thought that maybe He was up to something. We were preparing. I mean, listen, you know God's at work when you have a Southern boy who can't sing, setting up a computer with speakers that big to play music through and is leading the singing. But I was setting up one Sunday for the worship, and we were setting up the computer and all this, and about 12 people I'd never seen before in my life walked in and sat down. And that's the point in my heart which I said, okay, all right. Maybe you are up to something.
They like your singing.
And
They like your singing.
See there? No. So we met at the Best Western for 18 months. And then we found this place over here. And listen, this place had been available across the parking lot from us, and I'd rode by it, and I never looked at it because it was an old chiropractor's office. And I'm like, what are we going to do with that? I did not know that in the back there was this big workout exercise room, and one of our members got on her tiptoes and looked through the door, and she said, I think that'll work. And it did. So we were there from... It's hard to say. Yeah. We were over there for about 3 years and had a great experience. While we were there, ended up developing kind of a different logo, which is the next one. So, still not great, but improved. And we used that for a while on a very crafted website and various things like that. Another thing you probably wouldn't know is that... As that other situation at the other church was falling through, Cindy met Donnie's wife. Donnie's pastor, Moorhead, One Harbor. Cindy met his wife at a ladies' function. The girls got together and said, our husbands have to meet. We did. He ended up being a good friend through the pain of that church situation falling apart. And they also sort of supported us in some ways. To the extent that when we found this new property and moved into this new building, they bought all of our tables and chairs when we moved in. So that was really great. And one of their graphics guys designed us a new logo, which is that one. So that's where that came from. But here's the picture of the outside when we moved in, got a sign, new logo on it. And God began from there. And really, when Grace Church first started, we were probably 95% Marine Corps, 90% Marine Corps. It was a heavy dose of, and we just saw that as an assignment. God's given us an assignment to minister to these Marine Corps families and Navy families, Navy corpsmen and stuff. So that's what we're going to do. And in the midst of that, I remember hearing a statistic that said, if you're ministering in a military area to a military constituency, you'll have a brand new church every 3 to 5 years. And I was like, oh, Lord. We have to do this over? No, it don't go boom, boom. But our growth was, it was a good thing, because our growth was kind of like a heartbeat that would reduce and expand and reduce and expand. So we never got overrun, which was great. But we slowly, slowly grew in that building. Until we ended up moving over here. And that's another story. I won't spend time on it. But just when we decided to stay in that building for another lease, this one came open and we moved over here. So it was a provision of the Lord. A few things about Grace Church. Our mission is the Great Commission. It's the mission of the church. Mission of Grace Church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ in obedience to the Great Commission in Matthew 28:18-20. All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Notice Christ is King now. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. So we've been striving to be faithful with the gospel here. Faithful with the gospel in this area, in our Judea, seeking to become influential with the gospel as the Lord would bless it outside of this area. Seeking to make disciples who make disciples. So, vision for Grace Church. Next slide. Something I was committed to. A community with a robust theology that fuels joyful worship and a bold witness for Christ. So the answer is never to water down the theology. True unity is found in the truth, around the truth. And so we wanted to be sure that we were embracing a robust theology that was faithful to the Word of God, and that would fuel both worship and witness for Him. We sought for Grace Church to be a community that reproduces itself in other church plants. So far, we haven't been blessed to do that, but the vision was always to not get bigger than a self-supporting church here, right? And as we begin to grow beyond that, to then look towards, you know, Jacksonville or Morehead City or another locale to take a chunk of those people and work on a new church, or a new location anyway, a new church plant. So we never just want to get bigger and bigger and bigger in one area. We want to have functional, shepherdable size local churches with a plurality of leadership and someone to handle the preaching. Commitment on my behalf, you won't be beaming me out to other places, except for emergency situations. If we're going to plant a church, we're going to have somebody that's ready to go in and preach the gospel there, and they'll be much better off for it. So, but a community that reproduces itself in other church plants, and a community that's growingly lives up to our theme verse. We had adopted to live as Christ and to die as gain as something we were striving for, to have Christ be life and to live for Him and to trust Him and know that should death come, it is gain. So that's what we're about. Larger context, Acts 2:42-47. And you've heard this come out of my mouth before, but just looking at the characteristics of the early church. We know the early church wasn't perfect, right? But the apostles were on the scene, and this is how they were shaping things and what a faithful church looked like. And so, and they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of the bread and the prayers, and awe came on every soul. And many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. Signs of an apostle. Another sermon, but just hinting at it. All who believed were together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. So that's just a sort of a snapshot of at least what I would call a healthy early church that was experiencing God's blessing and growth. And so that's kind of what we were patterning ourselves by, to make sure we were prioritizing what God prioritized. And the apostles' teaching came first. Bible, fellowship, breaking of bread, sacraments, prayers, taking those things seriously. God was at work building His church. So begun it with our history. It's a little bit of our history. I mean, I can tell you more if you want it privately. But God saved us. God burdened us. God provided for us. God took us to seminary. God brought us here. He's provided for everything we need. We've walked through a lot of hardship and trials in the process. But the reason Grace Church is here is not us. It's God working through. He can take a crooked stick and draw a straight line. You've heard that before. And by God's grace right now, it's no longer just one elder and nobody else. And it was one elder and one deacon, or a deacon in training and then a deacon, and two elders and a deacon. Right now, as we sit, we have four elders and four deacons. And we're working through the nomination process to see if the body is recognizing other men that God has gifted for either one of those offices. And we're fairly sure we'll see some more deacons come on board, and we'll see about the elders. So, but we're trying to be purposeful. We're trying to train men. We've had a preaching class going on, and just trying to be diligent and purposeful to raise up men to serve in the office of elder and deacon. So when you go back to the slide number two, that was the picture of the baby. That was the baby that had been born through much pain and labor. That was the core group of people that God used to encourage us and support us and surround us. And there were churches around us and individuals around us from many states that chipped in and adopted the burden and helped us work to see the gospel planted here in Swansboro. So that's really the first section. Any questions on that or comments? Yes, sir, Mike.
Why report when there's such a
vote? We're going to get there. Okay. Yeah. That's in the theology section. Now, short answer is because I was Reformed. So believe that to be biblical. You know, as Charles Spurgeon said, Calvinism is none other than a name for biblical Christianity. So I believe that. So, anything else? All right. Anybody need a break? Take a bathroom break, dessert break, coffee break. Everybody good?